I'm getting famous. If I shake in my bitch, I'm all up my back and then all up my business. I'ma put it back, I ain't said it, ain't no earless. But please don't get offended if I say, if I say. That's my bitch, that's my bitch, that's my bitch.
Hey guys, welcome back to my YouTube channel. It's your girl, Onika. So today I have one of my lovely OG CEO friends. So, would you like to introduce yourself to my audience?
Give me a second, because the audience needs to, you guys need to wait for this. Drum roll, please. My name is Charlene McCarthy Krabby. I am 26 years old, and I am your Miss Trans Global Ghana.
Tell me about, a little about Charlene.
Okay, so I was born... I was born and raised in London. I'm actually originally from Ghana, and I've got heritage from Ghana and Jamaica. But let's just say I'm Ghanaian, forget that was that. Anyway, so I was originally...
She is Jamaican and Ghanaian.
But I'm Ghanaian, And I was raised in London, but then I obviously went back to Ghana a couple of times to grow up there. I went to school there about three times, well, about 3 years in my growing up period, I guess. But mostly it was done in London. I am a fashion designer. I actually also work for British Airways as cabin crew. Yes, chicken or fish. And I do like makeup. I used to do makeup. I'm weird. And I'll explain later on why I'm doing stuff. But I do makeup. I've got a cooking company. We do a lot of things.
You need to advertise yourself.
Ghani. Yeah. So we've got a cooking company called MSC Kitchens. MSC Kicks. Follow us. We do continental food, girl. Caribbean, Ghanaian. Caribbean, West African. We do Italian. We do Chinese. But it's like different cuisines every weekend. You got this, girl. And then we have my clothing line. I've actually had since I was 13. And that's actually my main thing. I'm actually a fashion designer. And then we also have my printing press that's there. And then I do little small businesses around.
Very good. So this is... And what are your pronouns before we go further?
I am she, her.
And what are you?
I am a female. I'm a woman.
Okay.
Have you seen this? This is all woman.
Woman. Very good.
Do you see anything else?
So tell me, were you born and raised in the UK?
So I was born and raised here, yeah.
Okay. And
to some extent. So I was born here, then moved to Ghana. We grew up there a little bit, moved back.
It's almost 5 o'clock.
Yeah, it's fine. It's today, guys. Full time today. Is that up for me?
What I want to ask you is, how was your, you're British, how is your upcoming as a British gay young child coming up?
Okay, so, you know, the funny thing is, I feel like for me, it's a bit different because I would never classify myself as gay. One thing. And I feel like as trans people, we should never classify ourselves as gay because at the end of the day, it's LGBT and we're the T.
Do
you understand what I'm saying? Like, we're not gays. There's a mental understanding that we're not the same. We are women.
Yeah.
That have been born in the wrong gender, they don't identify gender. So first thing first. We are trans, honey.
You're trans
woman. We are trans woman. And trans is not even the word. Let's give them a little bit of a lesson, honey. Let's give them a lesson. It's called gender identity or gender dysphoria. Do you know what I mean?
That's a diagnosis.
Honey.
But I was not diagnosed. But I know I'm a woman.
I'm a woman, but that's the concept. Gender dysphoria. Did you get it? Yeah, when you don't identify the gender you were born with. That's the concept. But I say, like, in the UK, it's weird because growing up, I was very surrounded by like a lot of Christian family.
Yeah.
My church is opposite my house. I was very involved in the church. I am very still much involved in the church. No one can tell me anything. I'm a Christian. No matter how you guys feel about it, everybody will go to church and whatnot. It's none of your business. I'm going to go to heaven. It's me and my walk with God. So that's the one. So all you ones are going to write down in the comments, you better go for it, girl, because it's not going to affect me.
You're not going to affect another.
Period. So, like I said, the first one, I'm a Christian. And being grown up in a Christian household, I was very sheltered. Like I didn't have outside friends. My family's really big, so all my friends is my cousins.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? My cousins were like that. Mom's sisters, yeah. My cousins and friends. So we go church together with no other cousins. Party together with no other cousins. So I didn't know anything about gays.
Yeah.
I didn't know anything about LGBT, trans. Only thing I knew is that, only thing I actually knew was gay. Do you know what I mean? So I feel like I was mis I misidentified myself initially, and I feel like that's where we now need to make sure that people don't do that, because we're not gays. A gay person is someone who likes a man that knows they're a man and is attracted to males.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? We're transgender.
We are women.
There's something completely different to us. Do you know what I mean? So that was the first bit. So growing up, I kind of identified as gay, but then the only reason for that is because I knew nothing else. Yeah. I used to think I was the only one in the world that was going through this, honestly. Until I was about like 19, because I was that sheltered. Like, I only found my freedom when I went to university. When I went to university, when I kind of like started meeting new people,
integrating,
understanding new people. I saw someone, I was like, oh my god, there's one girl I met. I was like, and she was like, oh, then I was like, what's that? And she's like, oh, I was born this and I changed it. And I was like, oh my god, like, it was like an eye opener for me. Like, oh my god, this person is literally like me.
Okay, not too much information.
Yeah.
Okay, because you need to answer.
Sorry, I took a lot.
So, what would you say is like going to school? No, before I ask a question, at what age you know you was different? I'm meaning, you're not different.
Always was different.
But okay, what age you know you was different as a, you know you was a
woman? Oh, like when it came to like
sensation, when it comes to
woman. I think it was probably like when I was probably like 5, 6. Mm-hmm. Because when it was like mine was almost the 20s. It was more so of my dad had your mom used to force me to do like football and all this other stuff, boy stuff.
Yeah,
do you know what I mean? Yeah, yeah. And I'm like,
they don't know
what is happening here? Like, all the girls are over there, they're running around. I know, okay, let's. My earliest memory was in school.
Mm-hmm.
You know, have you guys, you know what I mean? Do you guys feel like a game called Kiss Chase?
Yeah.
Where like the boys would chase after the girls.
I kiss them.
And they kiss them.
Mm-hmm.
Why is the boys not chasing me?
Right.
That was me. Why is the boys chasing me? Am I not? It was like that, because that was in like primary school. It used to be like in the playground in preschool, like before you go to like, because you used to, you know, in primary school there's two sections. You have the smaller section where you're from reception to like year three, and then year three up where you have a bigger playground.
Mm-hmm.
So in London school, the League of Little Playground, I'm running around, the guys are not chasing me. they say girls run, and I'm running. Do you know what I mean? I'm fully running.
Sorry to laugh, but
and I'm looking back and there's no boys chasing me. And I'm one time I caught up one of the girls. And when you run with the girls, you catch up with the girls, you're and she's expecting me to kiss her. I'm thinking, no, I'm hiding.
Sorry.
No, I hiding, just hide. She it was kind of like, and then she's like, but you know, you're meant to kiss me. No, I'm not. You're meant to kiss us. And I remember we're going back home and I kissed her. Mom, why is it that the boys never chase me to school? I'm saying, yeah, because you're a boy, you have to act like a boy. And I'm thinking,
yeah.
And that was the realization of, oh shit, like we are, maybe there's something not right here.
Yeah.
It was more like there's something not right here. Like, I don't know what to say. It was a weird, because it's weird. I don't know. Do you know, I feel like for people like us, like our sisters and everything, they can understand what I'm talking about, the feeling. But when you realize that someone come and told you you're not, it's a bit like, it's as if you're extra confused.
This is why I always say this, and I think they should put it into implement. Like, when we're going to sign up for our hormones, the only person will know what we're going through is someone that went through or went through.
Mm-hmm.
These are straight people they put in as doctors and doing these jobs. Yes, they know what we're going through, but still, you need to put at least have one person working in the department
that understands
what we are actually going through and actually felt it.
I feel like, don't forget, I believe in that saying too, and I feel like nowadays you're going to see more of that, because back then there wasn't. No, there was no open spaces for people to now go and train as a transgender doctor. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
They'll be looked at as really weird and disgusting and everything. It's now that you're finding that trans people are taking up spaces that they didn't before.
Yeah, that's true.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So I feel like soon we're going to start seeing those trans doctors. That's why I love 56th Street.
Mm-hmm.
56th Street, this is all of them. They're all scattered there.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? All the doctors that you did, either a trans, LGBT, someone who grew up the diaspora, they'll understand us. But like that feeling, I'm not going to lie, that feeling I can never forget. That thing almost like,
sorry about that, guys.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So you're gonna move from back to forth. The girl, so funny. Stay there, girl. No, but I feel like that was the concept. You know what I mean? When you're like, what do I do? What do I say?
Yeah.
How do we deal with it now? that feeling I'm never gonna forget. I'm not gonna lie. That feeling where my mom was telling me, duh, 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 duh. And I remember from that point onwards, it was so much so of, you need to behave like this, you need to do this.
You need to come like this. A ball, you need to
I said, my dad needs to put me into football, boxing, all these other sports. I was even like so confused about. The only thing is, I was really good in my hands. Making stuff with my hands was really, really a good thing. So, I think it was more so my mom. Just put it like that. But my mom's amazing to me. She's amazing. She's an amazing parent. But it was more so of her. And I think that's because of how our family was structured.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean?
So, just now I need to turn back. So, but, and you went to uni? Did you go uni?
Honey, girl, I went to girl.
And how was your experience in university?
Okay, so for I feel like university kind of saved me as an individual. Because I remember the first time I went to university, I went with my dad. My dad told me that she dropped me. And when the first time I got there, people used to ask me, are you gay? And I used to shy away from the concept of being gay because of how church and everything was. And I used to be like, no, I'm nobody. I don't like anybody. Because that was the concept. I just realized because I couldn't understand who I was as a person, maybe I didn't like anybody. I wasn't meant to be with anybody. So my mom was, I don't like anybody. So I was like, oh, you're, there was a name for it. Asexual.
Asexual, yeah.
And I was basically like, maybe I am asexual. And they were like, you're lying. You like niggas. As soon as you look at that nigga going looking through. You like guys. And I was like,
listen, you know what I don't like, right? You know in school, you ever had a like childhood school crush?
God,
like this boy, this one boy, you know, you could,
God, I had a lot of honey.
How far are you in your transition? And how is your transition going so far?
So with me, first thing I'm going to do again, I do not say transition. I'm trying not to.
Mm-hmm.
Not before, we used to always do it. When you need to,
yeah.
But I now want to say journey because I personally believe I'm not transitioning. I'm actually changing anything.
Mm-hmm.
All I'm doing is mirroring how I see myself.
You're fixing yourself to your brain.
To how everybody sees me externally.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a journey. That's like any other journey that anybody will go into. That's if you're growing up, you're growing up. So I'm going through my journey. And I've been going through my journey for about 3 years now. Initially, there was some small factors that, you know, I feel like were more private to me.
Mm-hmm.
That I had to understand when I went to start my journey. And that made me understand more of why I felt like I was trans,
mm-hmm.
or why I would identify as trans or whatever, because of hormonal imbalances and all these other things that I had when I was born.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's been 3 years. It's been pretty good for me. I feel like I've been a hormone for about 2 years now. Come see 2 years.
That's good.
And honey, you can see it's working. Look, this is the whore and the mount.
Mm-hmm.
We can see it. That's good,
baby. That's good. Hold on, let me just fix back myself. Yeah. But what I want to say is that how is coming out as trans living in London?
Mm-hmm.
How is your relationship life? What's your relationship to be?
Is it like relationship with guys or relationship with family?
Relationship with guys. So finding love.
Oh my
god. Easy. Are you in a relationship?
I feel initially I used to think before I transitioned because I was this overweight. Guy, like this overweight individual. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I would not say guy. I would say thing because I was never a guy.
Mm-hmm.
I was a thing, an overweight thing that is didn't have, that have no confidence. I remember I dated one person, the person actually accepted me for who I was at the time, but it was always based on like, because I had my own businesses, I was running my own things, I used to find guys that used to like that, do you know what I mean? So they used to have their own money as well. And I used to realize that the relationship that I used to have with those people was all based on money. I think when I started going through my journey, one thing I then realized was that people don't just like me for the fact that I may be nice or I may be really a business person, but they now like me because I'm just awkward or I'm just different type of woman.
Yeah.
Forgetting that I'm actually a normal woman, does that make sense?
Yeah,
because they see, do you understand? Do you know what I mean? Like, and if people don't understand that, for example, some people say a unicorn, this beautiful woman with a penis.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? I'm not gonna tell you what I have downstairs because it's all changed now, but let's just say,
mm-hmm.
do you know what I mean? Initially, it was like, oh, we like this person because you look like a beautiful woman and you have this special thing there.
Yeah, so it's like a
do you know what I mean? Like, I was kind of like a toy.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And I feel like a lot of guys, initially, when you're dating them, they're treated like a toy. You're like a toy, a plaything to them.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I want to have you for now and I'll throw you away for tomorrow and I'll keep you a secret. And I wasn't about that. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that's when I decided that I need to be able to do something different.
Yeah.
Because I feel like what I was also falling into was this concept that like, because I didn't have money at the same time and everybody took me as a toy, I feel like I can get money from guys. And then I feel like because we don't get this like thrown away from our families, sometimes people we're all left into this option of okay, being an escort, use the money for guys.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Take no harm for anybody. Go out of the day, we've all been there, we've all done it. Do you know what I mean? But at the same time, what I believe is that for us to take spaces and for us, like for example, you saying like going to the business, seeing doctors and everything, that's we need to now force ourselves to go into those lives.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And I was like, okay, I'm with this person, I go to university, I've gone this now. Let me force myself into all these different lives. I can force myself. That's like,
become a normal woman.
Yes. Do you know what I mean? So but then it's being a normal woman and also letting them know that yes, I am trans. So that it's like
when I'm not ashamed to say I'm a trans, but still I'm a normal woman.
I'm a woman, yes.
Yeah.
So like for example, if you decide now today, I want to get up and go and work in Sainsbury's, or I want to go and work in British Airways. Mm. Oh, they have a representative or that person before.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Not because before they didn't have representatives of trans people, but they used to hide. They'd be like, okay, I'm trans like this, mm-hmm. and then they'll hide and they won't tell no one that they're trans.
Yeah.
And then it'll just be like them working secretly in the company. Mm-hmm. And when a trans person actually comes, it's like, oh my god, there's a trans person here, but they're not knowing that there was a trans person out there all along.
Yeah.
That makes sense. Because even at British Airways, there was like 4 trans girls that were working for British Airways. We don't even know they were trans.
Yeah.
Because obviously they were so beautiful and so pretty and so passable. But the truth of the matter is, there were 4 girls that were already there. Mm-hmm. But then they'll find it so hard for me to transition or for me to go through my journey within the company.
Mm-hmm.
That's because those girls weren't openly about it.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
And not because of black alone, I think because she's black, but at the end of the day, they met one person.
Yes.
And they're now seeing this whole different person. You know, some of them are so ignorant and stick in the ways, they'll be like, they prefer to see as one woman, come as a woman, come as this.
Yes, and that's
so
it. It's hard. It's hard to feel like, but at the end of the day, like now it's happened and it's like no one else can deny who I am,
mm-hmm.
especially because I've already stepped into that position.
Yeah.
That means that I've stood my ground in that position. I feel like that's what we need to do. Stand your fucking grounds in positions and no one can deny us.
No one can deny us. As I always say, I'm the first black transgender woman from Trinidad and Tobago.
That is.
I live in London, influencer.
And you used a word earlier. You used one word earlier that I was kicking for.
Consistent. This is what we need to say, consistent. Yeah. Because they might be before me, but they were not consistent. So they're not noticeable.
Thank you. And that's on period.
So tell me, are you in a relationship?
Of course I am.
So give me a little bit closer to think about
this. So first thing, what we're not gonna do, we're not gonna give no names.
No, that's PG, obviously. But we're just gonna let it pick.
Okay.
Because we never had a trans woman. That is in a relationship.
For all you transistors out there, girl, you can do and be anybody you want to be. My partner is an amazing person.
You don't need to say it's professional.
No, I'm not gonna say
it's age.
He
says background.
Oh, he's the same age as me, he's from West Africa. He's actually 5 months older than me, funny enough. And he met me as me, he actually didn't know I was trans initially. That was a crazy thing. He didn't know I was trans initially. But when I did tell him, yes, he did disappear for like a week. But he came back because he then understood that there was more to us talking and getting to know each other,
mm-hmm.
than who I was before
but
he met me.
One thing.
Yeah.
My love. He disappeared from me. No, these men do that. Like, I swear.
They disappeared.
They disappear for a long period of time.
Then, like I said, I brushed over really quickly.
Yeah.
He scattered.
He scattered for a week.
Then I said, I said, after 1 week of talking to me, telling me you like me, I'm everything. Oh my god, you never believe you met someone like me. I told you the truth, now you
scattered.
But then he did the friend. So even with, you know, I feel like it's weird because I feel like I'm very lucky,
mm-hmm.
because not a lot of trans girls get opportunities that I've got
to come back.
For them to come back. Yeah. Because they do this.
No, I don't get one or two to come back, but they come back because they went and researched and they found out the stigma that the internet has.
Yes.
So like it's a fetish, it's this. But we are normal human beings because baby, you're not coming. I'm a bitch. I always tell people that I'm a bitch. And I have a standard, I have a type. And if I can't get that standard and that type, bye.
Because you know when he came back, it was just like he first apologized for disappearing,
mm-hmm.
and he actually said that he needs to get himself right with the concept.
Yeah.
And I said that's fine. But then the thing is, what I would say, what wasn't easy, was the fact that you now have to deal with this person that's come back and is accepting you for who you are. But then now they are confused about themselves because they don't know if Because then, but then I remember we both went to like a psychiatrist therapist because it was like a thing that became an issue, mm-hmm. and I wanted to speak about it, which I mean. And one thing that was very apparent was, did you meet Charlene as the previous person? Mm-hmm. No, you did not. Did you meet Charlene? Yes, you did.
Yes.
Who did you meet? Was it a woman or a guy? It was a woman. You cannot be gay. Yeah. Being gay means you are attracted to the male physical form. Mm-hmm. There's no way that I look like a male. No. Not in any way. I'm so sorry. Even if I did look, even wasn't, if I was even masculine, I had a big jaw, like, babe, I got booty, I got curves. Do you know what I mean? We look cute, we can't, honey. Do you know what I mean?
We are the CEOs.
There was no way you could. Do you know what I mean? So that was even a thing. So even for him at one point, that was a really big thing because it was a bit like, because I'm this and I'm that. And yeah. He also needs to come over.
I get that a lot. And especially like, so do you have this? Do you have that? And if I sleep with you, are you going to be this? Are you going to be that? And it's such a long, a book of questions they ask when they find out. And if they didn't know, you were in trance.
Like I said, I was very lucky because some people, they would get attacked, get beaten up, getting hurt, do you get me? And that happened to me. They accepted me for who I was. Mm-hmm. And since then, oh my god, you even know.
Yeah, I know.
Ah, amazing individual.
So one thing is, can you remember how we met?
I met him on Tinder. And funny enough, I did not lie on Tinder.
Yeah. No, but I said we.
Oh, how did we meet? Oh,
talk about him.
So remember we were here, he didn't know. I didn't lie. Technically, I actually had it on my profile that I am trans, but I don't think he read it because he just saw the beauty and was like, yes. You know how how we're so beautiful. So they just see us and they go, wow.
Yeah, they just come and take a box.
Because wow, this woman's just gorgeous. Wow, she's gorgeous. Do you know what I mean? And it just confused their mind. Oh, gorgeous. Yeah. They never realized that. So when it came about later on, he's like, he had to go back and look again. He was like, oh, he actually did say it. But it was basically like, but then he really met me and he loved me. So it was kind of like, sorry. But anyway. Oh my god. Oh. The CEOs of London. So we were at a party, my party. I do these weird parties where I pop up every day. And I remember I walked in this hall wearing a blue outfit. Mm-hmm. I walked in this hall with my wig that was oiled up to hell. I didn't have to comb wigs.
Wait, oh, it was sheen.
It was sheen, honey. And all I saw was this. I saw this woman. Woman. And I say a woman because she's a grown woman.
Yeah.
Sitting there all nice and pretty star. And look how it is. I had this woman, how did she sit in? She's very,
Yeah, I was sitting very elegant.
I was like, this girl is very elegant. I was like, okay. So I went and left, the party popped.
Yeah.
I went by the speaker, then I saw this pretty woman again. But this time she put on a song. If a baby woman is alive, walking like a dog.
And that was it, yeah.
And that was it. And I'm gonna ask you outside. And I was like, bitch, with your friend. You took one picture, and then.
Numbers.
And for the rest of the history, honey. Mm. And have you seen now here?
We see you.
Girl. We see you for a lot of girl. Mm. We've gone through a lot, girl.
Thanks for a lot.
Packing through the house. Girl.
No, don't sleep those nights.
Huh? And sleepless nights.
Honey,
but it's been amazing. Oh, been me nice and you was
up
fucking
and down, but nice shit.
It hasn't it. Girl, we did this, bitch. You say, it's the walking like a dog for me. They're walking like a dog. See, it's
walking like a dog. It was Santana, yeah. We had fun that night, but the party was nice.
It was nice.
Until the police come, but let's.
Girl, that was, we need that for another story.
We need that for another story time.
Because that party popped, girl. Mm-hmm. Honey, woo. Woo!
But I asked you, I don't think I'll ask that question, but what I want to ask is that there's anything in the school system, because you've been to school over here, that you would like them to implement into the system like a morals and values?
Is that more so of like us being, going for our journeys of being trans, or was that more so of like, no, in general?
In general, but I mean like teaching, in that early stage, you don't have to teach it, but in high school.
I feel like in London schools, and I feel like, funny enough, recently, as of recent, and that's something that's very shocking, as of recently, it's actually happening, mm-hmm. where they actually, they have like, so the other day I was able, fortunate enough to go and speak to one of the schools, and they have a rainbow club, mm-hmm. where you can go if you're LGBT or your Q+, or if you're non-binary, they'll call you they, them. In your class, they will actually register your day or whatever. Wow. This was the school in the ghetto, honey, in Tottenham, girl. So if they're doing that, they're definitely doing other schools. But there's certain things that I've learned as an individual growing up in London, mm-hmm. that I personally believe that like, needs to change. It's more sort of like, in Africa, I feel like in the Caribbean, mm-hmm. there's some level of growing up and doing stuff on your own, fending for mm-hmm. yourself.
Yeah.
In the UK, they do a lot for us. So true. you find that you grow up wanting help for mm-hmm. everything and not being able to do stuff that you need to do on your own. Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. They give you help for this, they sit beside you, if you go to the section, sit beside you for this and that. And that's one thing that they definitely need to do. They need to kind of own off on the back or even take the time off to teach you how to do stuff on your own.
Mm-hmm.
With us being a cute class trans people, I feel like making people understand from earlier that we aren't different, because a lot of the stigma is that we're different and we're disgusting and we're coming to ruin the world. No one's coming to ruin the world. No one's disgusting. Do you get what I mean? For anybody out there, like I said, I'm Christian. Anybody out there who's trying to tell me that God hates me, God don't hate me. I'm God so sorry.
Sorry.
Do you get what I mean? God don't hate me. God could never hate me, because it's all about love, and that's the concept. Yeah. And if my decisions of what I do for my life is gonna affect my outcome of where I go to, that's for me to deal with, mm-hmm. my cross to bear. Does that make sense? But there's other things in the Bible that you can still do to continue spread his word, tell him about his love. Do you know what I mean? But that also needs to be implemented in schools. The concept of explaining to people who we are and that we are like any other person. I'm still human. Do you know what I mean?
Yes, I still have feelings.
I still have feelings. I change my gender. I still got two eyes. I still got a brain.
Yeah,
I still got a mouth.
I've got red blood going.
I still got red blood that comes. If you cut me, it's not going to be black blood that's going to come out of me. Do you know what I mean? I'm not anything different. I'm just like anyone else. And I feel like there's this big stigma that, oh my God, the trans, you're this, you're disgusting. Mm-hmm. I'm not disgusting. Because at the end of the day, anybody could be trans. And the sad thing is, the majority of people and most of the household, there are people that are off the spectrum. And I personally believe like sexuality is on a spectrum.
Mm-hmm.
Do you get what I mean? No one's just straight and no one's not queer. Do you get what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, it's a spectrum. There's how much you like girls and how much you don't like girls.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know what I mean? How much you like boys and how much you don't like boys. and you fit within that spectrum. Yeah. Do you get what I mean? Some people are here, they like girls more than they like boys. Some people like boys more than they like girls. Depending on who they are, it shouldn't be a problem. Because that's their life to live. No one's the same.
Mm-hmm.
No one's the same.
And the last question I'd like to ask is, what one thing in the LGBT community you would like to change in London now? Just one.
Is that our community? Because we know there's so many communities. There's the LGBT community. There's a T community. There's the G community. There's the L community.
The LGBT community.
The whole thing.
So well, that's one
we thing. We need to stop hating our own and accept our own. No, that I think that's the one thing. The day that we start accepting our own is the day that we can actually come together and actually make a difference for all of us.
Yeah.
Because right now it's a lot of, oh, you stand over here. You're lesbian. Mm, you're over there. Mm-hmm. But the truth of the matter is, girl, we're all different and we're all in a
the alphabetical.
Yes, we are all we are all the minority. Mm-hmm. Does it make sense? There's no difference between us, and that's one thing as LGBTQ+ people, we do a lot. We like to segregate everybody. We complain about people that are segregating us, but we can segregate our own anyway. So if we stop doing that, maybe then we can actually start making a change.
Mm-hmm.
And for the you said one, but I got two girls. And for the trans girls, we need to stop comparing each other to each other.
Yeah.
And accept everybody as sisters.
Because everyone's journey is different.
Yes. We're all sisters, we're all the same. Do you know what I mean? We've all gone through the same struggles. The same way, like I was able to explain to you the day that I thought process, mm-hmm. and I was like, oh my God, that was such a weird feeling. No one else from our community, from the LGBT+ community, can understand that except from
our sisters. Yeah.
So we need to stop doing, oh, you're better than me, I'm better than you, you're hotter than me, you're not, because at the end of the day, no one's hotter than anybody. Yeah, some people can be possible, some people aren't, but that's not the point. The point of the matter is, yeah, that we are living in our truth.
Mm-hmm.
And we're living as we see ourselves in our head. Period.
So, one more thing. Tell them, what are you doing at the moment?
God, it's a hard list.
No, not that list. I mean, what you're representing. in what competition you're doing and let's advertise it.
So, like I said at the beginning, my name is Charlie McCarthy-Krabby and I'm your Miss Trans Global Ghana. I am representing Ghana in the international pageant called Miss Trans Global. Mm-hmm. And I'm going for the Miss Trans Global Queen crown, hopefully to be crowned your Miss Trans Global 2021. Mm-hmm. But if not, at least one of the top five winners, because at the end of the day, we're all queens at the end of the day. And I did win my own individual heat and that's to win, that was represent Ghana. So that's who I am, that's what I'm doing. And next year, guys, they are taking it out. So all the transistors out here, no matter where you are, do you get what I mean? I'm raised and I live in London, but I was representing Ghana, and that's because I've been there as well. If you are in another country and you do believe that you identify that country, you can definitely apply for Miss Trans Global and try to represent your country.
So, guys, thank you. Don't forget to subscribe, like, and hit the notification button, and all her information will be in the description box. Bye.